I know that if I share a message of repentance to these people and they actually repent, that you're going to forgive them. And I don't want any part of this. See, he wasn't afraid of rejection or of the enemy. No, he was actually afraid that God would succeed, that God would be, in fact, merciful to these wretched Assyrian people, to these wretched Ninevites. Because in Jonah's mind, they deserve hell. They deserve wrath. And Jonah said, I don't like this plan, God. And I don't want any part of this plan. I don't want any of this. And so he runs away. And him running away, essentially, is what he's saying is, I quit. I'm no longer a prophet. Forget me. I am gone. I don't want any part of this anymore. Your call, your mission, whatever it is, I want to leave. And so that's what he does. That's essentially why he runs away from the presence of the Lord, even though it is a direct command of God. This is how I'm going to use you. But Jonah goes down all the way to Joppa. But the truth is, you might run away from God, but you cannot outrun him. As we see in verse 4, the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up. Then the mariners were afraid. Each cried out to his God, and they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. As Jonah tries to flee from God's presence, what happens? God runs towards him in the form of a storm. He sends a great storm upon the sea, so powerful, in fact, that it begins to break the ship apart. And the ship is not the storm is not a natural occurrence. This is divine. There's something about this is divine, specifically targeted to stop Jonah. And the sailors, as we see in this text, they are seasoned veterans of the sea. They are afraid. Now, if you ever ride a plane and you see a stewardess panicking, oh my jeez, my heart would drop. Like, what is it? What's going on? And then the oxygen mask comes out and you start panicking. This is essentially what it is. These people are panicking right now, because the ship is about to break apart. And so one of the things that they do is that they know, and that these pagan sailors identify, this is what's so unique about the story, they identify that this is a divine thing. Something's going on. Some God is doing something. And so they correctly interpret their world and their time. And so that's why they start crying out to their own gods, hopefully appeasing whatever God we've angered or whatever God it is. Let's start praying. And not only that, they start throwing away cargo, trying to figure out, but nothing's working. Meanwhile, and just kind of imagine this scene, it's havoc. People are screaming, crying, praying, just darkness all around, boats, the ship is just tumbling back and forth. In the midst of all of this, what is Jonah doing? He's sleeping. He's sleeping. Isn't that crazy? Crazy. I can't imagine that he's sleeping, because the boat's probably like this. So how can you sleep like that? But he's sleeping. Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had laid down and was fast asleep. And the captain said to them, "What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish." Jonah, who is the cause of this storm, is found below deck, asleep. While the sailors are frantically trying to figure out, praying, trying to survive, Jonah shows no concern. He's asleep. He doesn't care, even though he's the cause of it. His deep sleep is a stark contrast to the sailors' desperation. And notice there's a repetition of the word down. He kept going down. He went down to Joppa. He went down into the ship, and he laid down to go to sleep. And we're going to talk about this, because this was his state of where he was in as he was running away from the Lord. He kept going down, a decline. And the captain, astonished to find Jonah asleep, he wakes him up, and he commands him not to help him with cargo, but look at what this captain says, pray. Isn't that humiliating? A pagan telling a prophet to pray. It's like a church member coming to a pastor. Hey, do you read the Bible? Do you pray? It's something. And look and notice, there's a word here that's very important. It's the word arise. Because it's the same word that began this entire story. God came to Jonah and said, arise. And so for Jonah, as he's hearing this, he knows it's the Lord. He's using these people to come and to speak to him. But Jonah, how he interprets it, yeah, he might just continue to be ignoring it. He doesn't pray, in fact. There's no evidence that he does pray. He's silent throughout this entire time. Verse 7, and they said to one another, come, let us cast lots, that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. And they said to him, tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation? And where do you come from? What is your country? And of what people are you? And he said to them, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, and who made the earth, who made the sea and the dry land. Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what is this you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. They recognized that the storm was a divine cause. And so they're trying to figure out, hey, who messed up? Someone messed up on the boat. And so that's why they cast lots. And so there's no escape for Jonah because the Lord made sure that the lots cast fell on Jonah to be exposed. He is the reason. And the lot falls on Jonah and it reveals exactly that. And instead of immediately, and this is where we get to see the hearts of the sailors. I don't know if you were a sailor, but if I knew, I'd be like, why'd you come on this boat and throw him over? But you look at them, they just begin to question him. They ask questions. Asking a series of questions. Hey, where are you from? Who are you? Where'd you come from? And Jonah's brief response reveals the truth. I am a Hebrew and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. And this is incredibly alarming to them because they believe in, they have their own gods, but their gods are small. Like they have regional, tribal gods, like the God of, I don't know, San Jose, right? That's my God. And it's the God of the tech world. And, you know, if I give money to him, he blesses me through tech. I don't know, just an example. God, this is the God of Silicon Valley. And they had these regional gods, but then when they hear Jonah, I believe in the God of everything, the sea and the dry land. They are shocked. They're shocked that Jonah's God is not some local God. He is the creator of everything. And so the sailors now understand Jonah's disobedience to this powerful God has brought upon this very storm. And so they realize that Jonah's rebellion has put them into grave danger. You know, this interaction, I just want to point out, is very reminiscent of something. What is it that you have done? That question. Does anyone remember where that comes from? Yes, it's when Adam and Eve fell in sin. And the Lord comes and says, what is this you have done? And then even the series of questions, right? They didn't say, you are the man. How dare you? They started asking questions. And so even at this moment, you get to see God using these pagan people really reaching out to Jonah with questions, coming to him to be able to confess, to repent. And Jonah, he is a prophet. He has memorized all of Scripture. If you are a prophet, you memorize Scripture front to back. So he knows exactly what this is. What is this you have done? A very sobering question, in fact, probably for Jonah. Verse 11, and then he said to him, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous. He said to them, pick me up and hurl me into the sea, then the sea will quiet down for you. For I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more against them. Therefore, they called out to the Lord, O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life and lay not on us innocent blood for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. They asked Jonah, what can we do then? What can we do to get out of this mess? It's a very sobering thing too for the sailors to do this because now they realize they are powerless. And so they go to the man of the Lord and they ask him for instruction. To interpret, for application. And Jonah says something very simply, throw me over, and the sea will calm down. And notice that the sailors, however, are very reluctant in the beginning. They don't want to. They don't carry out Jonah's suggestion. They start trying to row themselves back, but it still doesn't work. But they have compassion. There's a restraint. It's very, in contrast to Jonah's disregard for their well-being, you get to see, in fact, there's something for them on their side. And despite being pagans and having every reason to save themselves, they don't. Until finally, they have no other option left. And so before throwing Jonah overboard, there's something that they do. They pray. And this is the first prayer of the book. It's not the prayer of a prophet. It's a prayer of a pagan. Pagan sailors. And they pray for the first time to the God of Israel. And if you look at this prayer too, there's something, it's very simple. It's a prayer that says, God, we're going to do what you told us to do. We're going to follow and trust you. Because if this is all true, if this is your storm and this is your prophet and these are the instructions, God, this is not on us, this is on you. We're going to trust you. We're going to put our entire lives on you. And they did. So they picked up Jonah, hurled him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. And the men feared the Lord, the sailors, exceedingly. And they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. With no other choice, the sailors picked up Jonah, threw him into the sea. And as soon as Jonah hits the water, the storm stops. Sailors worship, make sacrifices, and make a vow to follow the Lord. The sailors are saved. And God sends and appoints a large fish to swallow up Jonah for 3 days and three nights. That's the story of Jonah, chapter one. Two takeaways for us. Sin. Remember how we started. Everyone is nameless in the book of Jonah, except two names, Jonah and the Lord. Why is this significant? The Bible wants us to focus on Jonah. Because the purpose of his prophetical ministry, which is going to be very unique, is to be a mirror for its readers. His life is to be a mirror for us, to show us our spiritual condition. Throughout the book, we get to see a very different perspective on sin. Sin is more than just doing wrong. It's running away from God, running away from his presence. Jonah's disobedience reveals that sin is not simply breaking a moral code or doing wrong things. It's about turning our backs on God's presence and his will. He was running from God's calling, his purpose, God's purpose for him, and ultimately from his presence. And this points to the essence of what sin is, a heart that rebels against God and seeks its own way. This is the essence of sin. Jonah did not want and like God's plan. And so he ran away. And this points to Jonah's disobedience, which is a powerful reflection of our tendencies to flee from God when we know God's call. C.S. Lewis, before he became Christian, in his B.C. days, before Christ days, in his B.C. days, he was an atheist. And he writes a very powerful, a very powerful reason why he was an atheist. And it was his resistance to God wasn't just about rejecting religious ideas, but rather it was a refusal to acknowledge God's authority over his life. And here's the quote here. Read along with me. But of course, what mattered most of all was my deep-seated hatred of authority, my monstrous individualism, my lawlessness. No word in my vocabulary expressed deeper hatred than the word interference. But Christianity placed at the center what then seemed to me a transcendental interferer. There was no region, even in the innermost depth of one's soul, which one could surround with a barbed wire fence and guard with a notice, no admittance. And that was what I wanted. Some area, however small, of which I could say to all other beings, this is my business and mine only. Lewis's quote here hits right on the human condition. We have areas that we put fences and say, this is mine. No admittance. And we can do this with people, But even spiritually, we do this with the Lord. You can have my Sunday mornings, but not the other days. You can have, and I'll trust you when it comes to salvation, but when it comes to your teaching about money or work or giving up my life, I'm going to put my fences there. I'm going to put my boundaries there. When it comes to trusting the Lord with all our heart and leaning not on our own understanding, only on certain things, God, I'm going to put my boundaries and say, Lord, you are not admitted in these parts of my life. And this is the tragedy of sin, however. In our effort to preserve control, in our effort in putting up these boundaries and signs against the Lord, we lose the very thing our souls need most, which is connection with God. And what does this result in? Notice, repeatedly in Jonah 1, we see the phrase, he went down. He goes down to Joppa, down into the ship, and down into the depths of sleep. And this is the consequence of sin. Sin will always lead us downward into spiritual decay that will become less and less human in the way that God designed us to be. Jonah's downward journey into sin is marked by several symptoms that reflects his spiritual condition. And these are warning signs, in fact, for us to examine our own lives. And this isn't a comprehensive list, but these are the things that we can identify, especially in Jonah chapter 1. First is prayerlessness. This is what we get to see, his descent. A prophet was noticeably silent in this entire chapter. A lack of prayer is often a sign that we are distancing ourselves from the Lord, unwilling, refusing to communicate with him or seek his will. Second, joylessness. Would you say Jonah is joyful at all in chapter 1? I don't think so. I think he's very angry, disappointed, silent, in fact. And you get to see the stark contrast between the sailors and Jonah. The sailors, you see a progression from fear to worship and wonder. But for Jonah, he is marked with joylessness. Joylessness is a symptom of running away from God. When we are out of step with God's will, our hearts will grow cold towards him, will resent him. And we lose the joy that comes from his presence, a joy of enjoying the Lord. Third, another symptom, restlessness. Jonah may be sleeping, but he really isn't sleeping. He's not at peace. How can anyone be at peace when the world is chaotic? The world that you've created is bringing chaos. Absolutely, he's sleeping, but he is not at peace. Sometimes we can have this false sense of peace when we think our way is the right decision, and we use that term, like, I'm at peace with my decision. But beware. I believe Jonah was at peace with his decision, but it was a false sign. We become desensitized, or really true peace is the result of living in harmony with God's will, not running away from it. When we're obedient to the Lord, that's where true peace will come. But restlessness is often masked by distractions. Fourthly, we get to see numbness. Jonah's deep sleep while the storm raged symbolizes his spiritual numbness. He was completely indifferent to the chaos, to the danger his action had caused. He became desensitized to the gravity of his rebellion, ignoring the ways of his sin and how it affects others. He could care less about the sailors. He could care less about the Ninevites because sin, the more we run into it, it'll make us self-centered. And we don't care. It's only really about me. And sin, however, is never isolated. It always has ripple effects, and it always harms others around us, whether we realize it or not. And finally, he was compassionless. A prophet who should love people, who should love like the Lord has loved, lacks love, lacks mercy, lacks grace. He was a man who was supposed to preach grace, but he was a stranger to grace. He didn't know kindness as a friend. It was distant because he was running away from the Lord. These symptoms of sin, which were evident in Jonah's life, can also be present in our lives. You know, when you're driving, the one of the things I hate is when that check engine light comes on, right? Ah, it's the worst. What do you do when that happens? What do you do when that time comes? Do you put a tape over it? Do you kind of just ignore it? Just kind of worry about it? Are you one of those? Or do you Google it? What's the best thing that you could do? Get it checked immediately, especially check engine, get it checked. But sometimes we do run away. We find ways to rationalize and just kind of distract ourselves. When these signs come out, get it checked. Go to the Lord. But at times we run away. At times we just continue to go down our path thinking that our way is the right way. But may this be a time of repentance, to return to God's will. Because ignoring these signs will continue to let us go further down into spiritual decay. Because the guarantee of sin is rock bottom, always. It's the guarantee of sin. And I think we see lives around us, it is true, it's a testimony of those things. But not only is Jonah's name mentioned, there's the other name that is mentioned, the Lord. And we can see so much of the Lord and begin to see his work. We get to see grace. As if sin is running away from the Lord, grace is God's pursuit of us. God is pursuing Jonah. When Jonah ran from God's call, God responded in a way that might seem very surprising. He sent a storm. Was this storm a punishment? Was it retribution? Was it revenge? How dare you leave me? What kind of storm is this? It's a storm of grace. Jonah's story teaches us a vital lesson. Grace doesn't always come in the form of comfort. Sometimes grace comes in the form of a storm. And it's kind of mind-boggling, because grace in our minds, when you think of grace, what do you think of? It's like this kindness, and it's this prodigal son running into the father's arms, and it's this like wonderful movie moment, and it's love, and it's warm. But remember, the prodigal son made his own choice, rebelled against the father, and he fell. He was eating food from a pigsty. And it was at that moment, when he hit rock bottom, that he realized his need for grace. When God convicts us of our sins, that is a form of grace, deep grace. When he finally makes us wake up to realize how far we have fallen, this is a form of grace. And this is what the storm was set out to do. The storm was Jonah's own doing. And yet, God sent this storm as a form of grace into his life. God's grace doesn't always come in the form of a gentle nudge. Sometimes it comes in the form of a violent storm. Because at the heart of it, God loved Jonah too much to let him continue down on a self-destructive path. He sent the storm to wake Jonah up. As he was going down and down, he sought to wake him up. Think of a parent. If your child runs across the street, what are you going to do? Are you going to gently hug? Gently walk to them? No, you're going to dash to that child. Even grab their arms, especially if they're close to the street. And it might hurt them. But you grab at whatever cost, because you want to protect and save them. And this precisely is this case. The storm was God's way of tackling Jonah, helping before he goes even more downward and destroying himself through disobedience. The storm was not meant to harm Jonah. No, in fact, because without it, Jonah would have continued on his downward spiral further away from God. God doesn't send storms to destroy us. He sends storms to save us. And this is what we get to see here. His grace is relentless. And in Jonah's story, we see this when Jonah finally surrenders. He finally comes to his senses. And he tells the sailors to throw him into the sea. And when they do, the storm will stop. He interpreted correctly. Then God sends a great fish, not as punishment, but as protection, to save him from drowning and giving him a second chance. The ultimate example of God's grace through a storm is found in Jesus Christ. Isn't it funny that the same thing happened when Jesus was on a boat? It's the same, very, very similar story. Jesus on a boat with sailors, and he was also asleep. Both Jesus and Jonah were on boats caught in storms. Both were asleep while others panicked. Both were woken up and called to take action, and both storms were miraculously calmed. But there's a key difference. Jonah was thrown into the sea because of his own disobedience. Jesus, on the other hand, was thrown into the ultimate storm, the storm of God's wrath, not for his disobedience, but for ours. Jonah ran from God's call, but Jesus perfectly obeyed the Father's will, even to the point of death. Jesus says this in Matthew 12:40, "For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." Jonah was thrown into the storm to save the sailors, but Jesus was thrown into the storm of God's wrath to save us. Jesus is, in fact, the true and greater Jonah. Jonah ran from God's call, but Jesus willingly obeyed the Father's call, even to the point of death. What does this all mean? What does it all mean? It means this. Because, like Jonah, we all face storms. All of us do, whether you're Christian or not. And sometimes the storms in our lives, they're a result of our own wrongdoing, our own doing, our own mess. Sometimes there are times where it's just the hardships of living in a broken world. It's the reality. Sickness, law parts because of the human condition. But no matter the source of the storm, we can know this. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, we never have to face that ultimate storm ever again because of his love for us. Jesus has already calmed that storm, the great storm of eternal hell. Did you know, Christian, you never have and you will never face a judgment day because Jesus faced that for us on Calvary Hill. We don't have a judgment day because when that day comes, it is a grand entrance in the name of the Lord. And with that, then, if Jesus Christ experienced the ultimate storm for us, so every storm that we face from this point on, do you see, whether they are trials of hardship or even discipline, they're never meant to destroy us. But these storms are meant to transform us, that we would come to him, that God uses storms in our lives to wake us up, to draw us closer to him and remind us of his unrelenting grace and love that he has for us, his commitment to us. And so where are you today? Are you running from God's call like Jonah did? Maybe God has placed a clear calling in your life. Maybe there's something that God has placed in your life. There's a calling. But kind of like C.S. Lewis, there are areas in our lives where we put boundaries and said to the Lord, no admittance, no. But God's voice keeps whispering into our ears. What are we running away from? When are we going to start listening to the Lord and go into his presence? Jonah's storm shows us that running from God only leads to storms. Storms that are not sent to punish, but to bring us back to where we belong. If you're running today, know that God's grace is pursuing you. He's not wanting to condemn you. He's ready to welcome you back with open arms. And sometimes it takes a storm to wake us up, to bring us back to the Lord. Or maybe you're in the middle of a storm right now and wondering where God is in the midst of it. Perhaps you're dealing with financial struggle, broken relationship, health issues, or deep emotional mental health pain. It's easy to feel abandoned during these moments. Where is God? But remember this, God's grace is pursuing you even in the storm. The storms you face are not a sign that God has left you. No. It's the sign that he is drawing you closer to him, in fact. And so run to him. Maybe you're also, a third, you're facing difficulties because of someone else's life decision, like the sailors. They had nothing to do with this. They were just kind of victims in this. A family member or a friend or a coworker, a boss, a manager, because of their wrongdoing, now you're in this middle of a storm right now. What do I do then? I didn't do this. But notice what happens to the sailors. Notice what they do. When they identify the storm, they themselves surrender to the Lord too. They responded. They went to the prophet and said, what do I do? And when they were given instruction, they obeyed. They surrendered. They themselves gave themselves away. And then they got to experience the Lord themselves. So what if, friends, in this moment, as confusing as it is, as I'm in this storm and I didn't cause it, but what if? What if it's God's way of bringing you back to him? At this moment that was, I had nothing to do with this, and yet the Lord has sent this to bring you back to him. So wherever you are, know that God's grace is pursuing you. His grace is relentless, even when it comes in the form of a storm. So the question for all of us is, how will you respond? Will you continue to run away? Or will you finally surrender and trust the Lord by throwing yourself into the sea and allowing his grace to embrace you? Lord, we thank you. God, we pray, help us to see through the life of Jonah. Help us to see that we're all running away from you. There's certain areas in our lives that we are not ready to let your will, to let your authority over our lives. But Lord, we pray through the life of Jonah that we get to see the character of the Lord, that no matter how much we run away, we cannot outrun you. That you're here to transform us. You're here to bring your transformation upon us, because you're not finished with us. And so Lord, we pray that whatever we're experiencing here, there might be those of us who are running away right now. Lord, may this story of Jonah be a wake-up call. May this be the storm. Lord, for those of us who are in the middle of a storm, God, we pray that you would bring comfort into them. Not to use feeling as a measure of your love, but Lord, knowing your word and seeing that you are with us no matter where we go, that even though I walk through the valley of shadow and death, you are with me. And your rod and your staff, they comfort me because they yank me back. As you hit us with that staff, Lord, it wakes us up that you are with us. And Lord, for those of us who are in a storm that we have not caused, Lord, we pray that we would obey and trust in you. So we pray that you would make clear your command, your will, that we respond to you faithfully in obedience and trust and faith. And Lord, I pray for those of us who have not placed our faith in Christ. Lord, may we see this is the guarantee of sin. This is the guarantee of a life lived without God as King and Lord, is a life faced with storms. And in this case, if we don't turn to Christ, we will go downward and drown. But Lord, we pray, may you turn the hearts. And God, we pray that that we would wake up, that the Spirit of God would open up our hearts, and that we would receive Jesus as Lord and King. So Lord, we thank you. God, we pray that Jonah, as we continue to venture into it, Lord, we pray that you would do the work in our hearts, and that we would turn to you in repentance, and we would turn to you to see your good character and love. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. May we all rise and stand as we respond to the Lord in worship, into his grace and to his love.
In faith, I will believe. I'll remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours, I am forever yours.
Mountain high.
Mountain high or valley low, I sing out and remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours.
When my heart is filled with hope, and every promise comes my way, when I feel your hands of grace rest upon me, staying desperate for you, God, staying humbled at your feet, I will lift these hands and praise, I will believe. I'll remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son.
Love came down.
Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. And I am yours. I am forever yours.
Mountain high.
Mountain high or valley low, I sing out and remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever,
I am yours,
cause I am yours, and I am yours for all my days. Jesus, I am yours,
and I am yours,
and I am yours, and I am yours for all my days. Jesus, I am yours.
Love came down.
Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. And I am yours. I am forever yours.
Mountain high.
Mountain high or valley low, I sing out and remind my soul that I am yours. I am forever yours.
Let's take time to pray. Respond in prayer to the Lord. Let's pray to God through the life of Jonah that we don't just see what sin is, but we would also see grace, that God is pursuing us with his faithfulness, his character, his work, as we see in the person of Christ, that he came down to face that ultimate storm for us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you, Jesus. Lord, we pray, help us to see your grace and see your goodness. Help us, God. Lord, that we would see your beauty and see your love, God. Help us, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray. We pray God, we pray that we would see you, and God, we pray that help us to know that you are with us. Help us to know, Lord, that even in the middle of a storm there is your loving care. And so, Lord, we pray for your presence over us. Lord, for those of us who are running away, God, we pray that you would wake up, that we would arise, and we would go to you in prayer. And God, may you change our hearts so we would come to the Lord God, who is not filled with anger, because that anger has been all put into your Son. And so now all that there is a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit who is here to receive us with gladness and joy. And so, Lord, we pray, may we come to you, may we turn our hearts to you. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Strong and courageous, I live my life.